is Lee Harvey Oswald, OSWALD.
I really don't know what this situation is about. Nobody has told me anything except that I'm accused of murdering a policeman. I know nothing more than that, and I do request for someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
You have been.
Nobody said what?
Sir?
You have been.
Nobody said what?
Okay, man. Okay.
What did you do in Russia?
A policeman hit me.
Here comes Oswald down the hall again.
You fire that rifle.
Dispatches you people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges.
Oswald has hustled through a doorway.
And he told anyone he planned to kill the president.
He hasn't admitted killing the president to anyone.
You have any reason to believe that there's any organization behind him?
How is it he says there's nothing mentioned to him?
Well, I didn't know what he said. He says he didn't do it. We're still working on the evidence. This has been a joint effort by the Secret Service, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the Dallas Police Department, the Dallas Sheriff's Office, my office, and Captain Will Fritz has been in charge of it.
How would you describe his mood during the questioning?
Very arrogant. Mm-hmm. Has been all along.
What did he say, Chief?
He just denies everything.
Mm-hmm. How do you sum him up? As a man, based on your experience with criminal types?
Oh, I think it's a man that planned this murder weeks or months ago and has laid his plans carefully and carried them out and has planned at that time what he's going to tell the police that are questioning him at present.
What was his motive?
He didn't give any motive since he denies them both.
As we understand it, no one actually saw this man pull the trigger of the rifle that apparently killed the president. Is that correct?
That is correct up to this time in our investigation.
What about ballistic test, Chief?
The ballistic test, we haven't had a final report, but it is, I understand, will be favorable.
You think the smudged fingerprints that have been found on the rifle which killed the president will be able to establish the identity of the killer?
We hope so, but I couldn't say positive at this time that they will be.
Are you enough to convict him?
I don't know whether it would be enough to convict him or not. If we can put his prints on the rifle, or it certainly would connect him with a rifle.
We want to say this, that this investigation has been carried on jointly by the FBI, the Secret Service, the Rangers, and the Dallas Police Department. Captain Fritz has been in charge.
Has he made any admissions at all about the shooting of the police officer?
No, nothing. He denies everything. Mm-hmm.
I would say that without any doubt, he's the killer. The law says beyond a reasonable doubt and to a moral certainty, which there's no question that he was the killer of President Kennedy.
And will you ask death in the electric chair for Lee Oswald?
Yes, sir. We'll ask the death penalty.
How many cases of this type have you been involved in? That is when the death penalty is involved.
Since I've been district attorney, I've asked the death penalty in 24 cases.
And how many times have you attained it?
23.
In this man's apparent subversive background, was there any surveillance? Were police aware of his presence in Dallas?
We in the police department here did not know he was in Dallas. I understand the FBI did know that he was in Dallas.
Chief,
do you
normally
start a practice for the FBI to inform the police?
Yes.
Police
Chief, do you have?
We did not have.
But you were not informed.
We had not been informed of this man.
Chief, do you have any concern for the safety of your prisoner in view of the high feeling among the people of Dallas over the assassination of the president?
No, but precautions necessary. Precautions will be taken, of course.
Hey, officer.
Yeah, he's got to be. There he is.
There
he comes.
Now the prisoner wearing a black sweater is changed from his T-shirt.
We've been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot.
Oswald expired at 1:07 p.m. He died.
If he had lived, of course, he would be entitled to counsel. I think he is entitled to counsel now, and I think all of America now is entitled to have counsel for Lee Oswald so that we can find out, actually, what took place on November 22nd.
1 week after the assassination, President Kennedy's successor, Lyndon B. Johnson, appointed a president's commission with Chief Justice Earl Warren as chairman. The other members were Senator Richard Russell of Georgia, Senator John Sherman Cooper of Kentucky, Representative Hale Boggs, Louisiana, Representative Gerald R. Ford, Michigan, Alan W. Dulles, former director of the CIA, and John J. McCloy, former chairman, Chase Manhattan Bank.
Another Supreme Court Justice, Jackson, while presiding over the Nuremberg trials, permitted counsel to be appointed for dead Nazi generals who were considered to be war criminals.
Are you charging the Chief Justice with a cover-up?
Yes, I'm, of course, charging the government with not only suppressing information, but I'm charging the FBI and the Secret Service with operating this case from a theory that Oswald was the assassin, that he acted alone, and I'm charging them with pursuing investigation only along those lines and having no interest in any information which indicates anything contrary to their preconceived theory.
This film is a brief for the defense. Let us examine some of the preconceptions of the Dallas police and the FBI.
Chief, we understand you have the results of the paraffin tests which were made to determine whether Oswald had fired a weapon. Can you tell us what those tests show?
I understand that it was positive.
What does that mean?
It only means that he fired a gun.
What about the paraffin tests?
Yes, I haven't gone into that. The paraffin test showed that he had recently fired a gun. It was on both hands.
Both hands.
Recently fired a gun.
Gordon Shanklin, the FBI agent in charge at Dallas, added, quote, a paraffin test used to determine whether a person has fired a weapon recently was administered to Oswald shortly after he was apprehended Friday, 1 hour after the assassination. It showed that particles of gunpowder from a weapon, probably a rifle, remained on Oswald's cheek and hands, close quote. The test, however, showed no gunpowder on either hands or cheek, and no nitrates on Oswald's face. Confronted with but one possible interpretation, that the paraffin test results were consistent with innocence, the commission concluded that the test, formally presented as a cornerstone of the case against Oswald, was, quote, completely unreliable.
Investigation showed he was the only one missing employee. This description and name was broadcast.
That explanation is inadequate in two respects. First, Oswald was not the only missing employee. 48 employees were outside of the building when the shots were fired, and others left just after the shots, and many were not permitted to re-enter, and thus were absent when the police search began. And secondly, the Warren Commission report states, the police never mentioned Oswald's name in their broadcast descriptions before his arrest.
Now, he went from there to the bus, caught a bus at Lamar Street, went part of the way to his address over in Oak Cliff.
Was Oswald on the bus?
While on the bus, he said, told the bus driver the president had just been shot, and later told a driver that he'd been shot and left at the time.
This would indicate that it was his intention to kill the president.
Yes.
But the laugh wasn't Oswald's. The only source of the story, the bus driver, identified 16-year-old Milton Jones as the laugher. When asked if he could identify Oswald as his passenger, the driver replied, I could not do it. I wouldn't do it at the lineup, and I wouldn't do it now. No, sir, I couldn't. I could not identify him. Yet the Dallas police reports of their police lineups state that the bus driver made a, quote, positive identification, close quote, of Oswald. The bus driver denied that that was true. The commission concluded, quote, the commission is satisfied that the lineups were conducted fairly.
This is Dealey Plaza, Dallas, Texas. The presidential motorcade entered the plaza from Main Street. Turn north on Houston Street and southwest on Elm Street. The commission decided that the shots came from the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository while the limousine was here. Directly in front and above the limousine is the Triple Overpass, a railroad bridge. To the right, on top of a grassy knoll, is a wooden fence, landscaped with bushes and trees. Behind the fence, a parking lot. Further back, the railroad yard, with a 14-foot tower maintained by the railroad company.
The commission asked three master rifle experts to duplicate Oswald's feat of November 22nd. They failed. Was Oswald more skilled than the commission's experts? This is an interview with Sergeant Nelson Delgado, who served in the Marine Corps with Lee Harvey Oswald. Sergeant Delgado appeared as a witness before the Warren Commission. Sergeant, prior to your Warren Commission testimony, were you interviewed by agents of the FBI?
Yes, they came to my home in South Jersey to interview me. The first two visits, they came just to get my story, what I knew about Oswald, how close we were, and things like that. After that, then they started, the questions were tending to break my story down.
Sergeant, where are you now stationed?
Down in one of the missile sites in South Jersey. Have been there since prior to the assassination of Kennedy. I've been here now for 3 years, and this month, the 20th to be exact, I'm leaving for Vietnam.
When did you first meet Oswald?
Just prior to the Christmas of 1958, Oswald reported into our unit. Oswald and I got along very good together. We were, like I said, working the same jobs involving aircrafts and radar. We controlled them from the ground and ran intercepts. We were about 40 enlisted men that really participated in this job. All of us knew Lee, and he knew all of us. We got along fine. We had discussions.
Was Oswald interested in guns?
They say he was a gun enthusiast, but I recall many instances where we stood inspections, and he was constantly being gigged for having a dirty weapon and then taking improper care of his weapon. He was always reminded when he had to clean the weapon, never took it upon himself to do so.
Do you have personal knowledge of Oswald's ability with a rifle?
At the range, he couldn't prove by me that he was a good shot. As any person who's ever served in the armed forces could tell you, there's a part in the qualification that calls for rapid firing. This is done with 10 shots, 8 in a clip and 2 that you load by hand. They give you maybe 30 or 45 seconds to be exact to fire these 10 rounds. Well, when you fire these, then you stand away from your firing position until everyone has finished firing. Then the targets are brought down and scored. The targets are run back up, and they're dissed for the number that you have hit. Fives, fours, threes, or misses. Well, in Oswald's particular case, it was quite funny to look at, because he would get a couple of discs. Maybe out of the possible 10, he'll get 2 or 3 Maggie's drawers. Now, these are a red flag that's on a long pole, and this is running from left to right on the target itself. And you don't see this on a firing line too often, not the Marine firing line. And it's you can't help but notice it when you're seeing discs, round cylinder things coming up and down, and farther on down the line you see a flag waving. Well, that was going to catch your eye anyway. And we thought it was funny that Oswald's was getting these magazine drawers so rapidly, one after the other. And this is why I can't say, think that he would be a good shot, because a good shot doesn't pull this. He'll pull a three, but he won't pull a Maggie's drawer. It's a complete miss.
How did the FBI react to your statement that Oswald was a poor shot?
They tried to disprove this. They did not like the idea when I came up with the statement that Oswald, as far as I knew, Oswald was a very poor shot.
Do you feel that the agents of the FBI actually tried to get you to change your statement that Oswald was a poor shot?
Yes, sir, I definitely do.
Nine wounds, four to President Kennedy, five to Governor Connally, presented the commission with another puzzle. Did two bullets do all of the damage? A frame-by-frame study of film taken at the time proved that two of the shots occurred within 1.8 seconds. An impossibility. The commission agreed that the rifle could not be operated that quickly. Commission Counsel Rankin stated, "To say they were hit by separate bullets is synonymous with saying that there were two assassins." But two assassins did not fit, so a new assumption was made. One bullet struck both the president and the governor. A one-bullet, two-victim theory. Necessity dictated that the theory become a conclusion. However, Governor Connally, in a press conference...
"Unquestionably, when the first shot was fired, I recognized it as a shot. I thought of nothing else but that it was a rifle shot. I turned to my right. I had time to think. I had time to react. And I turned to my right to look back over my right shoulder to see if I could see anything unusual, and particularly to see if I could catch him out of the corner of my eye. Because I immediately
thought, the president.
Because I immediately thought of an assassination attempt the moment I heard the shot. I didn't see anything except just the general blur of waving, of people moving, but nothing really unusual. I did not see the president out of the corner of my eye, and I was in the process of turning back to look over my left shoulder, and had about come to the point where I was looking straight forward again, when I felt the impact of the bullet that hit me.
Which entered the right posterior chest, close to the shoulder blade, and coursed downward along the chest wall, taking out and fragmenting a portion of the fifth rib on the right. The bullet then emerged from the chest, evidently struck his right wrist, fracturing the lower portion of the right radius, and then entered the left thigh where it was spent.
I am convinced beyond any question of a doubt that the first shot that was fired did not hit me. Then I was hit. And I was not then, and I have no memory, no recollection of the sound of the shot that hit me. Beyond any question of a doubt, the third shot did not hit me.
Pictures taken at the time of the assassination confirm the eyewitness testimony, for they reveal that Governor Connally reacted to the bullet considerably after President Kennedy did. Two members of the commission seem to agree. Mr. Dulles. But you would then have the problem. You would think if Connally had been hit at the same time, would have reacted in the same way, and not reacted much later, as these pictures show. Mr. McCloy. That is right. Mr. Dulles. Because the wounds would have been inflicted. Mr. McCloy. That is what puzzles me. Mr. Dulles. That is what puzzles me. The commission countered with the news that Governor Connally was
merely struck a glancing blow to a rib, thereby explaining his delayed reaction. The hard evidence, which conclusively demolishes the commission's case, is that more grains of metal were found in one of the governor's wounds than were missing from this bullet. The commission's autopsy expert, Commander Humes, testified, "I do not understand how it could possibly have left fragments in the wrist." As to the fragments in the governor's thigh wound, Commander Humes added, "I cannot conceive of where they came from this missile."
The commission also stated, as you know, Mr. Holland, that the same bullet which hit Governor Connally first struck President Kennedy. Based upon what you observed from that position just above the street on the overpass, is that possible?
No. No, that Warren Commission is in error on that, because I was an eyewitness to that, and I know that the same bullet that hit President Kennedy did not hit Governor Connally. The first bullet, the president slumped over, and Governor Connally made his turn to the right and then back to the left. And that's when the second shot was fired and knocked him down in the floorboard. And it would have been impossible for him to turn had the bullet hit, the same bullet hit him that went through the president's neck.
And did you see the effect of the next bullet which struck President Kennedy?
I saw the effects of the next bullet that struck the president. Because it flipped him over almost on his stomach and the side of his head, and his head was laying on the edge of the seat. He was laying more on his stomach, and his foot was hanging out of the, over the car, edge of the car, upside down.
Bowers, what is your present occupation?
I am vice president of Lockwood Meadows Incorporated, which is a real estate land development company.
And where were you employed on November 22nd, 1963?
At that time, I was employed as a tower operator for the Union Terminal Company.
And where were you at about 12:30 that day?
I was at the south end of the terminal of the tower building, rather looking down toward the terminal and observing the motorcade as was everyone else in the area.
Could you tell us what you heard and what you saw from about 12 noon until the time that the shots were fired?
Well, for some time that morning, since perhaps 10 o'clock in the morning, we had had the area pretty well sealed off, and the policemen had been stationed on the triple underpass as well as other strategic corners in the area, so that there was very little traffic moving into this area at this time. This is a dead-end area which is used primarily for parking. After 11 or 11:30, there was practically no movement in the area whatsoever. However, about 12:10, give or take 5 minutes, there was a car which entered the area and probed around for some time. This car was a 59 Oldsmobile station wagon with a out-of-state license. It was muddy, as if it had just come in off of the road from some area where it was a red sandy area. It was occupied by one male who spent 3 or 4 minutes in the area looking it over, and then, as he found out, left by the entrance, which is the only way in and out of the area at that time. Not too long after that, perhaps 5 or 6 minutes, a car of a totally different description, also occupied by one male, entered the area. Now, this man performed a similar action, and he toured down around the area probing to examine the exits, and seemed at one or more occasions to have a mic or something resembling such an instrument up to his face. Just a few moments after that, the third car came into the area, and these were the only three cars that entered this area during this specific period. The third car was a 61 or 2 Chevrolet. This car was muddy all the way up to the windows, as if it had just come in off the road. It had an out-of-state license of the identical to the first car of the series, and it also had political stickers on it, which were not only for the same candidate, but were identical in nature and color, so that they appeared to have been from the same group. This also, this car was occupied by one male who spent a little bit more time in the area than the others, and probed down by the side of the tower where I was located. I could not state that these cars left the area entirely, because after they got back onto the extension of Elm Street in front of the school depository building, they were lost to my vision, so that they could have remained very close by.
Mr. Holland, on November 22nd, where were you?
November the 22nd, I was standing on top of the Triple Underpass, waiting for the parade and the president's car. I arrived about 11:45, or close to noon. Two policemen was talking to me and asked me, one of them asked me if I would come back up there and identify the people that had any business or had a right to be up there.
They would be railroad employees?
They'd be railroad employees, and I told him I would.
What was your position with the railroad company?
Track and signal supervisor for the Union Terminal Railroad. I've put in 41 years of railroad service in the signal department.
Did you look in any particular direction when you heard the shots?
Yes. I looked over to where I thought the shot came from, and I saw a puff of smoke still lingering underneath the trees in front of the wooden fence. The report sounded like it came from behind the wooden fence. And a policeman throwed his motorcycle down in the middle of the street and run up the embankment with his pistol drawn. He was running toward that particular spot. And also another motorcycle policeman right behind him tried to ride up the embankment on his motorcycle, and it turned over about halfway up the embankment. And he got out, got off his motorcycle, and left it laying there, and run on over to the fence with his gun in his hand.
Where do you think the shots came from?
Well, I know where that third shot came from.
Where did that shot come from?
Behind the picket fence.
Is there any...
Close to the little plaza.
Is there any doubt in your mind that that shot came from behind the
fence? There's no doubt in my mind. There's no doubt whatsoever in my mind in the statement that I made to, in the sheriff's office immediately after the shooting, and the statement that I made to the Warren Commission. And I made it very plain there was no doubt in my mind. What there was definitely a shot fired behind that picket fence. I made it plain to the Warren Commission, and I think I made the same statement in the sheriff's office. There was a fourth shot.
On November 22nd, Mr. Holland, did you tell the sheriff's office in an affidavit you signed that date that you saw a puff of smoke come from behind the picket fence?
I am certain I did.
Was it the general feeling, would you say, Mr. Holland, among the police officers and others, at the moment that the shots were fired, that some, at least one shot came from behind that wooden fence?
There's about six of eight of us boys from the Union Terminal run around there to find some evidence that there was someone around there. Certainly the ones that was with me that run around that fence realized what was happening. They told me the same thing that I told you, that there was definitely a shot fired, and they saw the smoke. We just all started running around that fence as a unit.
Where were you on November 22nd, Mr. Dodd?
I was standing on the underpass, Commerce Underpass in Dallas, Texas.
Were you there alone?
No, I was along with three friends of mine.
Railroad men?
Yeah, all railroad men.
Mr. Holland was one of them.
That's right.
And did you see anything which might indicate to you where the shots came from?
Well, we all three seen, four seen about the same thing as the shots. The smoke came from behind the hedge on north side of the plaza, and a motorcycle policeman dropped his motorcycle in the street with his gun in his hand and run up the embankment to the hedge. And then I went north to look around the corner to see if there's anyone behind the hedge, and met special agent at Katy Railroad, and he went down there, and I walked along with him to see if there were any tracks there, in which there were tracks, and cigarette butts were laying where someone had been standing on the bumper, looking over the fence or something.
Were you questioned by agents of any government agency on November 22nd, Mr. Dodd?
Yes, we were. We were taken over to the courthouse and questioned by, I suppose, Secret Service men of some kind. And asked me quite a few questions about the same as I've told you men here today.
But you were never called as a witness by the Warren?
No, I never was called.
Because here's the Warren report, and in the index your name is not listed, and there's no reference in the whole 888 pages to the fact that you were up there and you saw what you saw, you heard what you heard.
Well, I don't know about that. But there was something that looks to me like that going on there, that somebody should have found out something. A man walk up and shoot a man handcuffed to a couple of policemen and get away with it. Why, I figured there's something else that's going on besides what it should be.
There was a motorcycle policeman that just stopped his motorcycle up by the monument, and had drawn his revolver and was racing up the hill to the left of him. There was a deputy sheriff, which I think was stationed under the underpass, Buddy Walters. At this time, I says, you know, I felt something sting me on the face as I was standing down there. I said, just sting. And Walters looked at me and says, yes, says, you got blood on your cheek. He says, where were you standing? I says, well, down by the underpass. So we started walking down there. And when Walters got about, oh, I'd say 10 feet away, he says, look there on the curb. There was a very visible mark on the curb where a bullet had struck. Either a fragment of the bullet or a piece of the concrete. It flew up and scratched my face. And he said, go to the city police headquarters and make a statement, which I did.
Mr. Tague, this is a picture of Dealey Plaza, as you know.
I wonder if you'd be good enough to show me where you were standing when you heard the shots.
I was standing at the east end of the Triple Underpass between Commerce and Main. There's a little concrete divider there. It's about 3 feet wide.
And, sir, could you indicate where the bullet struck the concrete curb?
The bullet struck the curb on the south curb of Main Street. It would be right here.
And at the time that you first heard the shots, what was your impression as to the origin of those shots?
My first impression was that they had come from the left of me.
Would you indicate on the picture where that would be?
Up in this area here towards the hill.
Where in relation to that wooden fence?
Well, somewhere towards the wooden fence.
Mr. Tague, on the 22nd, when the shots were being fired, your first impression was that they came from the area near the wooden fence.
That's correct.
Where do you now think that the shots came from?
I believe that they did come from the school book depository because of the things I've read about, the evidence which has been brought forth in the newspapers and through the Warren Report and so on.
Mr. Nix, where were you on November 22nd, 1963?
Standing on the corner of Main and Houston.
And did you take any pictures of the presidential limousine as it went through Dealey Plaza?
Yes, I've taken pictures before and after, before the assassination and during the assassination.
And you know, of course, that your pictures were eventually used by the government to determine where the limousine was when some of the shots were fired.
Yes.
And did you deliver a copy of your film to the federal government?
Yes, I delivered a copy of my film to the federal government about December the 1st.
About a week, little over a week after the assassination.
Yes, my film got lost in the processing plant.
Where is the original film?
The original film belonged to United Press International. The government has a duplicate copy.
And where is that duplicate copy?
In the archives.
And is that the duplicate copy which was used by the Warren Commission for the purpose of determining, along with other films, the Muchmore film and the Zapruder film, where the presidential limousine was when some of the shots were fired?
I would say so.
Well, you now have a copy of your film, which you were kind enough to show to us this afternoon. Is that copy the same as the original which you gave to the FBI on December 1st?
I would say no. There is some films maybe missing, some frames. Some of the frames were ruined.
Does the film which you have at the present time have the same number of frames as the film which you delivered to the FBI on December 1st?
I would say no, but it's cause of losing maybe a frame here and there.
At the time the shots were fired, did you look at the book depository building?
No.
Did you think at that time that the shots came from the book depository building?
No, I thought it came from a fence between the book depository and the railroad track.
Did anyone else who you know or who you've spoken with also believe that the shots came from there?
Most everyone thought it came from the fence behind the book depository.
Did you have occasion to speak with Forrest Sorrells, who was, of course, friend of yours and the Secret Service agent in charge of Dallas that day?
Yes, I did.
Did he tell you where he thought the shots came from?
He thought they were coming from the same place.
Which is?
Behind the fence.
At the present time, where do you believe the shots came from?
Well, they came from the book depository because there's proof that it did come from there.
I see. This you've read in newspapers and you've read the report.
Yes. I believe the Warren Report.
We are in the basement of the Terminal Annex building on the northeast corner
of Dealey Plaza. We're here with Mr. J.C. Price, the engineer in charge of the building. Mr. Price, where were you at the time that the presidential motorcade drove through Dealey Plaza?
Well, I went up to the roof and where I'd get a better view of the cabin.
Is this where you were sitting on November 22nd, Mr. Price?
Yes, sir.
Right here?
Right here on this spot.
And where did you think you heard the shots come from?
From behind the overpass over there. Triple overpass. That's where I thought the shots were coming from.
And where did you see the man run?
Over behind that wooden fence, past the cars, and over behind the Texas Depository building.
Did you give that information to the Dallas Sheriff's Department on the very day of the assassination?
Yes, I did. I'd say in about 30 minutes after the assassination.
Were you ever called as a witness by the Warren Commission?
No, sir. No, sir.
I show you this map published by the Warren Commission of the Dealey Plaza area and ask you if you would mark on it where you thought the shots came from.
Yes, sir.
That's just behind the wooden fence where it joins the overpass. Is that correct?
That is correct.
We're now here more than 2 years after the assassination. Now, where do you think the shots came from on November 22nd?
Well, I can't be sure. It seems that from all information that's been gathered that the shots came from the Texas Boat Depository, but I can't hardly believe that, although I never did look over there at the building, but really I think the shots came from that direction. It seems that everything pointed to that fact that they came from the Boat Depository building, but I can't buy that right now. That's about it.
May I have your name, please, sir?
Bill Newman.
Billy, tell me what you saw and what you felt. What happened to you?
We just come from left field after seeing the president and the first lady, and we were just in front of the triple underpass on Elm Street, and we're at the edge of the curve, getting ready to wave at the president.
So you were down under the viaduct, so to speak, weren't you?
Well, we were halfway in between
on the grass,
triple underpass. We were at the curb when the incident happened. But the president's car was some 50 feet still yet.
In front of us
coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the president, I don't know who was hit first, but the president jumped up in his seat. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the president in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you, too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall. I don't know what you call it.
Do you think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president? Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, a little mound of ground near the garden.
Mr. Brehm, where were you on November 22nd, 1963?
I had taken my 5-year-old son downtown to see the presidential parade.
This is a picture taken by Mr. Nix of the limousine at the time the shots were fired. Do you see yourself and your boy in that picture?
Yes, sir. This is myself and this is my son on this frame here where the first shot hit the president. I would say that he was possibly 30 feet away when the first bullet struck, moved a little closer, and was possibly 20 to 25 feet away when the second bullet hit.
Did you see the effect of the bullets upon the president?
When the second bullet hit, there was the hair seemed to go flying. It was very definite then that he was struck in the head with the second bullet. And, yes, sir, I very definitely saw effects of the second bullet.
Did you see any particles of the president's skull
fly when the bullet struck him in the head?
I saw a piece fly over, in the area of the curb where I was standing.
And in which direction did that fly?
It seemed to have come left and back.
In other words, the skull particle flew to the left and to the rear of the presidential limousine.
Sir, whatever it was that I saw did fall both in that direction and over into the curb there.
You were a ranger during the war, correct?
Yes, sir, I was a ranger during the war. Took part in the invasion of France and was shot a couple of times, so as I say, it's possibly like swimming. I hadn't heard that sound for many a year, but you don't forget it once you've heard a shot rounding, coming close to you.
Did you speak with newsmen on November 22nd and tell them what you saw?
Yes, sir, and told them simply that there two shots had hit the president and the direction that I had thought the bullets had come from.
Did you at any time that day make a statement which was televised?
Yes, sir.
Fortunately, I was probably 15 to 20 feet away from the president when it happened.
Tell us exactly what you saw, sir.
He was coming down the street, and my five-year-old boy and myself were by ourselves on the grass there on Palmer Street, and I asked Joe to wave to him, and Joe waved, and I waved, and the man...
That's all right, sir.
You were ahead, Charlie. As he was waving back, he was the shot rang out and he slumped down in the seat. And his wife reached up toward him, and as he was slumping down, and the second shot went off and it just knocked him down from the seat. I'm positive it had hit him. I hope it didn't, but I'm positive that it hit him, and he went all the way down in the car. Then they speeded up, and I didn't know what was going on, so I just grabbed the boy and fell on him in hopes that there wasn't a maniac around. I'm sorry. I can't help you more, but I won't forget it.
Did you make a statement to the Dallas Sheriff's Office?
Yes, I did.
How long did you remain in the Dallas Sheriff's Office that day?
I was, say, about 3 hours to 4 hours.
Were you among the closest witnesses to the limousine when the shot struck the president?
Yes, sir, I would have to say that if not the closest, one of the closest to the unfortunate incident. I did get a view of something I'll never forget.
Were you called as a witness by the Warren Commission?
No, I was not called by the Warren Commission to testify.
Immediately after the shots were fired, there, of course, was a mass confusion, to put it mildly. But the area was immediately sealed off by, I would say, at least 50 police within 3 to 5 minutes. The first one to appear on the scene, other than those, who, of course, who were standing around, including two on top of the triple underpass, was one who rode a motorcycle up the incline coming up from the lower portion of Elm Street. And he rode perhaps two-thirds of the way up or more before he deserted his motorcycle. At the time of the shooting, in the vicinity of where the two men I've described were, there was a flash of light, there was something which occurred which caught my eye in this immediate area on the embankment. Now, what this was, I could not state at that time, and at this time I could not identify it, other than there was some unusual occurrence, a flash of light or smoke or something, which caused me to feel like something out of the ordinary had occurred there.
In reading your testimony, Mr. Bowers, it appears that just as you were about to make that statement, you were interrupted in the middle of the sentence by the commission counsel, who then went into another area.
That's correct. I was there only to tell them what they asked, and so that when they seemed to want to cut off the conversation, I felt like that was, as far as I was concerned, that was the end of it.
Mr. Bowers, how many shots did you hear?
There were three shots, and these were spaced with one shot, then a pause, and then two shots in very close order, such as perhaps Almost on top of each other, while there was some pause between the first and the second shots.
Did you tell that to the Dallas police?
Yes, I told this to the police, and then also told it to the FBI, and also I had a discussion two or three days later with them concerning this, and they made no comment other than the fact that when I stated I felt like the second and third shots could not have been fired from the same rifle, they reminded me that I wasn't an expert, and I had to agree.
Is this the exact spot you were standing on November 22nd, Mr. Holland?
That's correct. This is the exact spot that I was standing November the 22nd, waiting for the parade.
And where did you hear that third shot come from?
Right over about 20 or 30 feet from the other end of that little picket fence.
And where was the smoke that you saw?
It drifted right out underneath those green trees, those two trees.
From behind the fence?
From behind the fence. It kind of hung there just like a, for a few seconds, long enough that you could see that it was
and then what
puff of smoke.
And then what'd you do?
Immediately after the president's car came underneath this overpass, a four of us broke a run around this fence to find out if we could see anybody leaving the area.
Can we walk this way now that you went on the 22nd?
No, we can walk that way right now.
Fine.
We were trying to see what we could see, and
this was the direction you walked on the 22nd.
This was the direction. Made this right turn. Jumped this steam line, this pipe. One man right behind me jumped, and another one jumped right on top of him.
Fell on top of him?
Fell on top of him.
And were there more cars here on the 22nd than there are today?
They were bumper to bumper. Just a sea of cars. You couldn't hardly get through them. We were jumping over the bumpers, over the hood of the cars, to work our way to the spot that we saw the smoke and heard the shot. Then we came up to the wooden fence.
Mr. Holland, did you remain behind here for a while when the police officers were searching the area?
Approximately 15 minutes before I had to go back to my office. There was about 40 or 50 people around here searching.
And what did you find here?
A lot of footprints behind this car, mud on the bumpers. And I looked around to see if I could find some empty shells or any evidence of a shot being fired and the bullet shell rejected from the gun. And this is where I saw the smoke from the third shot.
Right drifting out around here?
Just drifting out underneath these trees.
And when that shot hit the president, as he passed by this lamppost, did you see the effect of the shot upon the president?
Well, it knocked him over to his left down in the car.
Away from here?
Away from here.
About where was he in relation, where was the car, the presidential limousine, in relation to the lamppost?
Just a little to the left of that lamppost we're looking at.
In effect, Mr. Holland, the Warren Commission published just a very small portion of your testimony and used your testimony as proof that no shots could have come from behind the fence. Did they accurately and fairly use your testimony?
They are wrong, because my testimony, and I made it very clear,
that there was a fourth shot fired, and one of those shots came from behind that picket fence. And there's no doubt in my mind, I never will be, because I was on the spot. I saw the smoke, heard the report, and saw the smoke from behind that fence. And I don't see how that they could doubt there was a fourth shot fired.
The vast majority of the witnesses who expressed an opinion as to the origin of the shots agreed with Mr. Holland that the shot did come from behind the fence. These witnesses, as this picture shows, were positioned throughout Dealey Plaza. The commission concluded that no credible evidence suggests that the shots were fired from any place other than the Texas School Book Depository building.
Mr. Holland, you were on the overpass. You were probably in the best position of any witness on November 22nd. In your view, did the Warren Commission present all of the facts regarding the assassination of President Kennedy?
Well, let me say this. The Warren Commission, I think, had to report in their book what they wanted the world to believe when they read the Warren Commission. As you know, as well as I know, that everybody in the world was reading this Warren Commission, and it had to read like they wanted it to read. They had to prove that Oswald did it alone.
In preparing its evidence, the commission suppressed one photograph, mutilated another, cropped a third, and made a mystery of a fourth.
And I took the picture. It so happened my picture, when I took it, was at the same instant that the president was hit. And that does show in my picture.
Did you realize what had happened when you heard the shot?
No, I didn't. There was, three or four real close together. And it was, must have been the first one that shot him, because that's when that was the time I took the picture. And during that time, after I took the picture, and the shots were still being fired, I decided I'd better get on the ground.
You did lie down.
I did. I was, no more than 15 foot from the car and in line of fire, evidently.
Did Mrs. Kennedy scream on the first shot?
I don't know about the first shot, but she did scream. She says, "My God, he's been hit, or he's been shot."
Now, the picture you took, I understand the FBI has it now.
Yes, that's right.
The federal police did have it on November 22nd, but it was never published or referred to by the commission. The agent who took it from Mrs. Moorman described it, quote, "Mrs. Moorman had taken a picture of the lead motorcycle officer. In the background of this picture was a picture of the book depository building and the window where the gunman sat when doing the shooting. A picture of the window at the time of the shooting? Why wasn't it published? Wasn't it conclusive proof of Oswald's guilt or innocence?" This is Commission Exhibit 5. It purportedly was found among Oswald's effects. It depicts General Walker's home in Dallas and was used by the Commission as proof that Oswald shot at General Walker. Marina Oswald was questioned about it before the commission. Question. License plate? Mrs. Oswald. "I would have remembered this black spot if it were there at the time the commission showed me this, or the FBI. When the FBI first showed me this photograph, I remember that the license plate, the number of the license plate, was on this car, was on the photograph. It had white and black numbers. There was no black spot
that I see on it now. Question. Who showed you the picture? The FBI, or the Secret Service, or the Commission? Answer. The FBI first, and then the Commission. Question. Now, at the time the Commission showed you the picture in Washington, was there a hole shown in the picture where the car's license plate should be? Answer. No, I don't know what happened to this picture, because when the Commission showed me the picture, there was not this spot here. If there was a hole, I would have asked them about it right away. Why that hole is there, or that black spot. Associated Press photographer James Oltkins took this picture as the first shot was fired. People all over the country asked, how could Oswald be downstairs watching the motorcade if he was upstairs shooting the president? The FBI puzzled over it too.
The reason the is going to be down in this area down here.
The commission said the man in the doorway was Billy Lovelady. Although Lovelady agreed, he also said he wore a red and white striped sport shirt, buttoned near the neck, and no jacket. No commission member ever saw Lovelady. Apparently, no commission member even saw a picture of him. The press was unable to obtain one. This is a previously unpublished photograph of Lovelady, taken by us from a camouflage position. Here is a picture of Oswald at the time of his arrest. Was the man in the doorway Oswald, or Lovelady, or neither one? If it was Oswald, that fact alone is proof of his innocence.
Suspect's name is Jack Rubenstein, I believe. He goes by the name of Jack Ruby.
Did you know Ruby before this?
No, sir. Saw him in this very same room Friday night when we had the defendant up here. If some of you will recall, he asked a question from out here in the audience, or answered a question. He's standing right back here, and I didn't know who he was. I thought he was a member of the press, and he told me as we walked out of here that he was a nightclub operator here.
What question did he ask?
What?
What question did he ask?
I don't remember, but maybe it was an answer, but he said something.
You remember it was Friday night when I asked you to look to me like your good friend. I don't know what it
was. We have not been able to find anyone of our men who saw and recognized Ruby at the time of this transfer.
The thing that I saw, I was waiting at the armored car to ride with the suspect to the county jail. I knew that they would bring him out. They had cleared the way, and then I heard the shot. I didn't see the gun. I just saw the struggle that ensued. I immediately ran from the armored car down the ramp and tried to help subdue the prisoner that had shot Oswald.
Now, do I believe that you recognize this man after the capture?
Yes, sir.
Did I understand you to say that if you had seen him before, you would have ejected him?
Yes, sir.
Well, now, as Oswald was escorted out, were the policemen to either side of him? Weren't there any in front of him?
Yes.
How did the man get by the policeman in front?
The only thing I know is what someone said he jumped.
This is Detective Jim Lavelle, who was this morning handcuffed to Oswald and was bringing him out to the car to be transferred to the county jail. Could you tell us what happened?
Now, you were handcuffed to him?
I was handcuffed to him and also had a hold of the waistband of his trousers. I saw this man come from the crowd, and at the time he emerged from this crowd of people, he was not more than 6 or 7 feet from me.
Could you see the gun in his hand as he came?
I saw the gun in his hand as he emerged from the crowd. crowd, but being such a short distance from me, I had no time to say anything.
Now, when Oswald fell to the ground, was he unconscious at that point?
I would say if he was not, he was nearly so. Just as soon as my partner on the other side, Mr. Graves, grabbed Jack's hand with the gun in such a manner that he couldn't fire it anymore.
Did you recognize him when he came through?
Yes, I have known Jack Ruby for a number of years, and I recognized him just as soon as he emerged from the crowd.
We are in the office of Napoleon J. Daniels, a real estate broker in Dallas, Texas. Mr. Daniels, have you been associated with the Dallas Police Force?
I was for 7 years.
In what capacity?
As a patrolman.
Where were you on November 24th, 1963?
Well, I was going down to inspect the assassination site around 11 o'clock, I guess, and I noticed Officer Vaughn standing on the Main Street ramp of the City Hall at the basement, and I stopped to go back to talk to him, and I asked him what his purpose was there, and he told me he was keeping anybody from entering the basement because they fixed to transfer Oswald.
How long did you remain in front of the Main Street ramp with Officer Vaughn?
About 20 minutes, I guess.
Did you remain there until you heard a shot?
I did.
From 11 o'clock until 11:20, did anyone enter the basement through the Main Street ramp?
There was one man about a couple of minutes before Oliver was shot.
Could you describe that man?
Yes, he was a white man, weighed about 175, and had on a blue suit. About 5'9".
What was the color of his hair?
It's brownish, and he's bald in the top.
Was there anything else distinctive about the gentleman?
He had his right hand in his right coat pocket, and something seemed to be protruding from it.
What was your impression when you saw him enter the basement with his hand in his pocket?
My first impression was that he had a gun in his pocket. And then I didn't think too much about it because Officer Vaughn didn't challenge him. He just let him go on down in there.
Did Vaughn indicate any recognition or knowledge of who the person was when the man passed by him?
Well, I just assumed he did because he didn't try to stop him. I assumed he knew who he was.
Did Vaughn allow anyone else to enter the basement other than that one man?
No.
How long after that man entered the basement did you hear a shot?
About time enough, I guess, for him to walk down in there and get settled.
Chief Curry, would you comment on the presence of Jack Ruby in the basement of City Hall while Lee Harvey Oswald was being transferred? How did he get there?
Well, of course, it's been pretty well established by this time that he came in the ramp entrance, on the Main Street entrance. And the officer who was guarding this door had stepped away to permit a vehicle to come out. It wasn't necessary that he do this, but he had stepped across the sidewalk to assist a vehicle coming out of the basement. And that's when Ruby came into the basement. And this was less than 2 minutes before Oswald was brought down.
Where was Officer Vaughn standing when this man entered past him?
He stood right in the center of the entrance to the basement there.
And what was his responsibility or obligation that day, do you know?
To not let anyone go down in there for them. I know.
Have you any idea why he allowed this man to enter past him?
No, I don't know, other than just he knew who he was or something. That's what I thought at the time. He had to know who he was.
Did Officer Vaughn look at the man who walked past him?
He looked in this direction, yes.
We are at the Lewiston Raceway in Lewiston, Maine, with Mrs. Nancy Hamilton, owner of the Hamilton Stables. Mrs. Hamilton, did you testify as a witness before the Warren Commission?
Yes, I did. On June 2nd, 1964, we have been a freelance investigator for various police departments, district attorney's offices, such as the Sacramento District Attorney's Office, Suffolk County, Massachusetts District Attorney's Office, Boston Police Department, and various private detectives.
And before that, were you employed by Jack Ruby?
Yes, I was. This was in 1961 in Dallas at his club, The Carousel, and I was bartender, waitress, and rather the manager there.
How did you get that job?
I had gone into Dallas not knowing anyone, and of course the first place I went was the police department. And they were very kind and got me the job there.
They got you the job at Jack Ruby's?
Yes, they did.
Did they know Ruby?
Personally, oh yes, very well. Vouched for him, wonderful person, great man. Well known by the Dallas Police Department.
What were your duties there?
Well, general bar duties, such as setting up the liquor, getting the bar ready for the evening trade, waiting tables if he was short-handed. Otherwise, I'd be behind the bar serving the drinks.
Did you ever serve drinks to Dallas police officers?
Oh, yes. In fact, the Dallas police officers were the special boys, shall we say. We even had a private stock for them.
Private stock?
Oh, yes. They wouldn't... bar liquor wasn't for them. We had names such as Hague and Hague or Black Label. The very, very high-priced drinks on the house, of course. You'd never... And that was a gross oversight if you ever charged a Dallas police officer or any official of the city of Dallas or Tarrant County.
Well, other than the Dallas police officers, what officials did frequent Ruby's establishment?
Oh, such as your district attorney, which would be Mr. Wade.
Did you receive any specific instructions from Jack Ruby about serving drinks for the Dallas police officers?
Yes, in fact, Jack told me point blank. He said, Nancy, if you ever, he said, intentionally or unintentionally, charge a Dallas police officer, he said, you might as well go look for another job. He said, don't offend them, cater to them, talk with them, even if you ignore the other customers. Bend over backwards to be nice to them.
Did Ruby perform any other favors for the Dallas police officers?
Well, yeah, well, favors, well, if we call them favors, I suppose so. He provided girls, gambling, and booze.
How many Dallas police officers would you estimate Jack Ruby knew on a personal basis?
At least half and probably two-thirds.
There were almost 1,200 police officers in Dallas in 1963. Would you say Ruby knew 600 of them?
Oh, easily.
A great deal has been written about the relationship of the Dallas Police Department with Jack Ruby. We have 1,200 men in our department, and we had each man to submit a report regarding his knowledge, our acquaintance with Jack Ruby. Less than 50 men even knew Jack Ruby.
You see, Jack Ruby was a man who wanted to be noticed, wanted to be known. And he used to frequent the Dallas Police Department. And he used to brag, I can get this fixed for you, or I can get that fixed for you.
Did the Dallas Police Department or District Attorney's Office ever do any favors for Jack Ruby?
Several that I could probably name, such as serving drinks a little late.
You mean Ruby was permitted to serve drinks after hours?
He did, and no one ever interfered. And, of course, it was common knowledge that he ran girls and gambling, and I've never seen him any kind of pickup on him.
Did you serve mixed drinks to police officers?
Yes.
Is it against the law in Dallas to serve mixed drinks?
Oh, yes, definitely, except in a private club.
This, of course, was not a private club.
No, open club.
So that every time you served a drink to a police officer, it was a violation of the law?
Yes, and I'd say I probably broke the law a few hundred times in doing so.
And of course, the police were witnesses.
Well, up to a point they were witnesses. After that, I guess they probably didn't care.
Johnson, when did you first meet Jack Ruby?
I met Jack Ruby in 1952 on Irvis Street, a place called the Silver Spur. I went to work for Jack Ruby in 1956. And the club was a Vegas club. I worked for him for about 6 years.
Did Ruby know many Dallas police officers?
Well, yes, he did. I'd say he knew probably half of the people on the force.
There were about 1,200 police officers on the force.
Yes, well, I'm sure he knew about half of them. And he was very nice to them.
We have 1,200 men in our department, and we had each man to submit a report regarding his knowledge or acquaintance with Jack Ruby. Less than 50 men even knew Jack Ruby, and less than a dozen had ever been in his place of business. Most of these that had been in his place of business had been in there because they were sent there on investigations or had answered a call for police service. I believe there was four men in our department that we were able to determine had been there socially, that is, off duty in the presence and were present in his nightclub.
Did you see police officers drop into the Vegas club during the 6 years you worked there?
Oh, very definitely. They would come in there all the time, off duty, on duty, and so forth. And
how were they treated?
They were treated royally.
You testified before the Warren Commission, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Did they ask you how many police officers Jack Ruby knew?
No, they didn't ask me that question.
I've just read your testimony, and as I recall, they ask you one question about a police officer. They ask you if you knew a policeman named Harry Olson. Mm-hmm. And you said you didn't remember the name.
That name didn't register with me.
But that was the only question they asked you about policemen.
About policemen, yes. They asked me numerous questions, but nothing about police other than that one that you just named.
We are at the office of Penn Jones, Jr. in Midlothian, Texas, 25 miles from the Dallas courthouse. For the past 2 years, he alone in the Dallas area has conducted an independent investigation into the assassination of President Kennedy.
Well, I love President Kennedy very much. I was one of the few weekly newspapers that covered the Ruby trial. And my actual investigating did not begin until I started reading the Warren Report and realized that something was very, very much amiss in reading that report. I really believe that the only way you can believe the Warren Report is to not read it.
Have you found it difficult to uncover the facts this time?
Yes, it's very difficult. Witnesses are reluctant. Some of them have gone into hiding, or at least cannot be found by me. And in many cases, the police have actually told, or in some cases, some witnesses say, federal authorities have told them not to talk about the assassination. The witnesses are frightened. Some of them went into hiding. I'm sure that I spent at least 1 month searching for Earlene Roberts. And I don't know of any person, any newsman, or any investigator that talked to Earlene Roberts after she testified before the Warren Commission, and her testimony was quite startling.
Mrs. Roberts told Commission counsel of a rather mysterious incident which occurred just after Oswald entered the rooming house on November 22nd. At approximately 1 p.m., she said, a police car drove up to the house at 1026 North Beckley and parked outside. Question by Commission Counsel. Where was it parked? It was parked in front of the house. Did this police car stop directly in front of your house? Yes, it stopped directly in front of my house. Where was Oswald when this happened? In his room. Were there two uniformed policemen in the car? Oh, yes. And one of the officers sounded the horn? Just kind of a tit-tit, twice. The commission did not satisfactorily explain why a police car stopped in front of Oswald's dwelling or why the policeman sounded the horn twice and then drove away just before he came out.
Now, of course, she is dead. And she's not the only one. There are at least 8 persons now dead, either from murder or at least strange deaths who were closely related to Jack Ruby or Lee Harvey Oswald.
Can you give us one instance of a witness who died a strange death?
Well, let's take the case of Betty Mooney McDonald, one of Jack Ruby's strippers. A fellow named Warren Reynolds saw a man running from the scene of the Tippit slaying. Shortly thereafter, Reynolds was shot through the head. Now, before Reynolds was shot, he could not identify the man running from the scene as Oswald. Then he was shot through the head, and a fellow named Garner was arrested. Then McDonald was the alibi for Garner. She said Garner could not have shot Reynolds because he was with me at the time. 2 days after her alibi, Betty Mooney McDonald was arrested for fighting with a roommate. Although the roommate was not arrested, McDonald was put in jail that night, and an hour later she was found hanged in her cell. And of course the Dallas police said she hung herself.
Did Reynolds finally testify before the commission?
After Reynolds recovered from his wound, he testified and was able to identify Oswald.
Mr. Reynolds, where are you employed?
At the Giant Reynolds Motor Company.
And were you working there on November 22nd, 1963?
Yes, sir.
How close is the used car lot which you work to the scene of the Tippit killing?
One block.
Were you there at about 1 o'clock on the 22nd?
Yes, sir.
And then what happened? What did you see? What did you hear?
We were listening to the radio about the assassination, and we heard these shots, and we ran out on this porch, and we saw this gunman running up the street, and I followed him for a block until I lost him. And then I was going back to the used car lot, and this policeman stopped me and asked me what had happened. And I told him that I had seen this man with the gun, and I had followed him, and I lost him. So he took the description and my name and stuff like that. And while I was talking to him, some television camera was taking the pictures. And after that, I went on back to the used car lot.
Were you questioned by agents of the Federal Bureau of Investigation or the United States Secret Service during November 1963?
No, I sure wasn't.
Were you questioned by FBI agents or Secret Service agents during December 1963?
No, sir.
Were you questioned by FBI agents or Secret Service agents during January 64?
Yes, sir, I was.
When was that, sir?
That was on January the 21st. Two agents come out and they talked to me and asked me what I had seen, and I told them, and they showed me three pictures.
You were questioned by agents of the FBI on January 21st, 64. Then what happened?
2 days after that, as I was closing up the used car lot one night, when I went downstairs to turn off the lights, some gunman was hidden down there, and he shot me. He shot me through the glasses, right here, and the bullet lodged right over here.
Mr. Reynolds, who knew about your questioning by the FBI between the time that you were actually questioned by them and the time that you were shot 2 days later?
Just friends and, of course, my family.
The commission concluded on page 663 of its report that it was wild speculation for anyone to think that there might have been a connection between the fact that you were shot in January and the fact that you observed the gunman flee from the Tippit scene. What is your comment, sir?
If they would catch the man and prove that he did do it, we could figure out from there whether he was connected or not. And until then, I don't believe anybody is smart enough to say whether it is connection or not.
That's one of the examples, and there are many others. Bill Hunter was shot through the heart in the police station out in Long Beach, California. Jim Cody on the Times Herald was killed by a karate chop to the throat in his apartment in Dallas. And the man that was the most likely suspect was not even indicted for the murder. The death of of Tom Howard. It's a very strange one. They said he died of an apparent heart attack. There was no autopsy. But I know personally that Tom Howard was acting very strangely 3 days before he died. I and other people who saw him felt like that he was very frightened. 3 days later, he was dead. Now, he was the man who saw Jack Ruby first after the killing of Oswald.
Well, whether these deaths are related to the assassination or not, does the fact that witnesses have died in this fashion tend to make it more difficult to secure statements from those witnesses who have survived?
Certainly, there is very little evidence, first-hand evidence left with the erasing of the lives of Tippit and Oswald and these other people who had first-hand conversations with either Ruby or Oswald. That has made the gathering of evidence very difficult. And the continued threats on these people who still have evidence makes them hesitant to talk, and it makes anyone trying to do investigative work very, very difficult.
Do you know of any witnesses, commission witnesses, who were threatened before they testified before the commission?
Mrs. Clemens was one. She witnessed the killing of Tippit.
Mrs. Clemens, where were you on November 22nd, 1963?
I was working for Miss Smotherman, 327 East 10th, just down the block from where Tippit was killed.
Did you know Officer Tippit?
Yes, I saw him. Pretty many times.
And did you hear the shots?
Yes, I heard the shots.
And what did you do?
I ran out into the street and looked down the street, and I ran back down the street where he was lying, and I looked at him.
Now, when you heard the shots and you went out of the house, did you see a man with a gun?
Yes, I did.
What was he doing?
Oh, he was reloading it. When I said he was reloading his gun.
And how would you describe that man?
Well, he's kind of chunky. He's kind of heavy. He wasn't a great big man.
Was he tall or short?
Yeah, he's kind of short guy.
Short and heavy?
Yes.
And was there any other man there?
Yes, there was one on the other side of the street. All I know, he told him the gun.
Mrs. Clemens, the man who had the gun, did he make any motion at all to the other man across the street?
No more, I told him to go.
Well, he waved his hand,
yes,
and said, go on.
Gone.
And then what happened with the man with the gun?
He unloaded and reloaded.
And what did the other man do?
Man kept going straight down the street.
And then did they go in opposite directions?
Yes, they weren't together. They went this way from each other. One down the shooting went this way. Other went straight down past street that way.
What was the man who did not do the shooting, but the man who went in the other direction from the man with the gun? What was he wearing, if you remember?
Well, first I can remember he looked like light khakis and a white shirt.
And was he tall or short?
He was tall.
And was he heavy or thin?
He was thin.
But the one who had the gun, seconds after Tippit was shot, he was short.
Yes,
and
he was short and kind of heavy.
Now, did you testify before the Warren Commission about this case?
I haven't said anything to anyone.
Did anyone come to see you after the murder of Officer Tippit?
Yes, he was a man who came. I don't know what he was. He came to my house and talked to me. But I don't know what he looked like, a policeman to me.
He did. Did he have a gun?
Yes, he wore a gun.
Mrs. Clemens, how long after Tippit was shot did this man with a gun come to visit you?
About two days. It was about 2 days. Said that I might get hurt. Someone might hurt me if I would talk.
About what you saw?
What I saw. He just told me to be the best if I didn't say anything because I might get hurt.
I would love to see a computer faced with the problem of coming up with the probabilities of the assassination taking place the way it did, with all of these strange incidents that took place before and are continuing to take place after the assassination. I think all of us who love this country should be alerted that something is wrong in the land.
Full name is Lee Harvey Oswald, OSWALD.